kind of in a reflective mood this morning, and just humbled to just be blessed to be here. Nice to see our visitors, Brother Richard. Good to meet you. I like your spirit.
Thank you.
Amen.
So you are a man who speaks out, and that's what men should be. They need to be men, not mice. Amen.
Amen.
I can't stand no mousy man. I'd rather a man be a little rough around the edges than a little soft.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Amen.
Them kind of guys make me a little nervous. But this morning, if you will, briefly, we want to turn to the book of Matthew, the 13th chapter. We're going to talk about the parable of the sower and the seed this morning. Read a few of these verses down through here and try to come up with a subject. That's what I've been sitting there thinking about, because the Lord is still dealing with me. Sometimes you have everything together, and sometimes you step up to the pulpit and you don't have nothing together. I stepped up here and had to change the message as I stand here. Thank God I don't have to do that this morning.
Amen.
Man, it said the same day went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside. And a great multitude were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat, and the whole congregate multitude stood on the shore. And we spake many things unto them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. When he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came up and devoured them. Some fell in stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up, because they had no depth, deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched. Because they had no root, they withered away. Some fell among the thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. The other fell into good ground and bore forth fruit, some in 100, some in 100-fold, some in 60-fold, some in 30-fold. Verse 9 said, He who had ears to hear, let him hear. And this morning, I just want to tell you, don't waste a good word. Don't waste a good word.
Amen.
In Matthew, there are 8 parables that he shares with us. And they all have to do with what is called the mysteries of heaven. Now, by mystery, Jesus doesn't mean anything mysterious, but it's just what is unknown or what is not revealed to us. There is a mystery, I guess, in the eye of man who doesn't understand, but it's not actually hidden. It's there for us to see if we're willing to learn of it, which means that we're going to have to put aside our own ideologies and our own thoughts. We cannot carry into the gospel of Jesus Christ what we think we know, what someone may have told us, and sometimes even what we have read, because these things have to be spiritually revealed. Mm-hmm. Believing with God is seeing. Some people say seeing is believing, but honestly, truthfully, with God, if you believe, then He will open your eyes and show you.
Amen.
I was reading this morning, and they were talking about in the world that probably 40% of the crop that is sown is lost. That means that only 60% produce fruit or produce a harvest. Which, when you consider the advent of the pesticides that we have and the other means we have for raising crop and how we genetically engineered our crop, and how we were able to different herbicides to control the pest, and how we know about moisture content of the soil and fertilization of the soil and what soil content is, how much acidity is good, how much alkaline is needed, what are the pH balances that are necessary to produce a maximum crop. Still to have a 40% loss is great. Mm-hmm. But in the kingdom of God, that number is much greater than 40%. If you look at Israel, in the time of Jesus Christ, there were somewhere around 80,000 to 100,000 people living in Jerusalem that were within just the walls. There were another 3 or 4 million Jews that were scattered around in various places. That's why Paul went to Greece and Rome and other places to minister the gospel, because they had been scattered. But yet, on the day of Pentecost, when they were in the upper room, there were only 120 people initially saved. And then on the day of Pentecost, 3,000 souls received salvation.
Amen.
So when you look at these small numbers, it tells you something about how seed is lost. What a waste of a good word. These multitude that came to see Jesus, and this is Jesus Christ himself, and he couldn't pull more than 120 or 3,000 real folks.
Right.
I'm not talking about people who just came because they were going to get something for them. And this is what happens when you start scattering as the word of God as seed among people.
Right.
Jesus was out in a house and he came and sat by the seaside. And so many people came around him that he had to go out on the ship so he could get away and speak to them on the shore. And he spoke to them in parables, because among those people that he was talking to, a lot of them just didn't get it. Because he was speaking to them in a parable. They come thinking that they were maybe going to get healed. They had maybe one of their cousins, Bocephus or whoever it was, or somebody had gotten something from Jesus, and he come back and said, you know, oh, the Lord doing it. So they come, that's why folks flock to church. You know, a great preacher, we had this great revival, we had a good time, we got this singer coming in, or that famous gospel person, or this big name preacher, and they're coming to hear them preach, and they're coming for this and that, coming for entertainment. Then we have a good time. But did you change? Did you get anything that caused you to really become a new person?
Right, amen.
Jesus is talking about sowing. He's talking about sowing into the mind. See, the mind is the field. And some people, when you deal with their mind, you can be talking to them as you're preaching, and they're sitting there while you're preaching, thinking about what they're going to have for dinner. Their word is falling right by the wayside. They're thinking about their problems. They got their mind wandering on family. They're thinking about their job, or maybe something in school, or what they're going to do, or this vacation they got planned, or something that happened. But they're not really tuned in to receive the word of God. And when they are like this, he says, the fowls can come by and devour up everything that you said. Now, fouls are anything that would distract a person from the word of God. The fouls come and get the scraps, and what that person is left with is what they thought they heard, or what they may have interpreted out of the message. And you go back and you ask them, what was the message about? What was the title about? What did he preach about? Oh man, it was a great message. That's all I can tell you. I know we had a good time. They didn't get anything. So, emotionalism in our churches today is distracting. It's designed to draw people's mind away from God. I've seen preachers up preaching, and you got folks over there waving flags. All this is going on. The man of God is preaching the word, and you got some guy over there on the keyboard hammering, bang, bang. So that the word is not absorbed into a person, because you're caught up in the music. Jesus didn't have music playing when he was speaking. As a matter of fact, let me tell you something. It is considered rude to be talking, making noises, or doing anything when a person is speaking. When the president of the United States gets up to deliver a message, there is nobody behind him on a hand of organ hammering the keys. Is there?
Amen.
And yet the greatest office in the world, or office that's held by the preacher of God, is distracted. See, this is just later time madness that has come in by these fouls that are out here. So the man of God is preaching, and somebody's half the time you can't even hear what they're saying. Mm. You see, this is what's happened. This is a waste of a good word. I know it's entertaining. I know it makes you feel good, but the point of coming to church is not to entertain you. It is not to make you feel good. It is to convert you. It is to educate you. It is to form you and shape you into a child of God.
Right.
Amen. Amen.
So the seed in churches right now as I'm preaching. Somebody somewhere preaching, somebody somewhere on the organ, somebody's beating on the drums, and the word is floating right off, and the fowls are taking it by the wayside. And if you go back and ask the people to repeat what that person just said, because it never got a chance to get a hold. It went in their mind, floated across, and was washed away by the flood of music. That seed never got a chance to sink in. It never got a chance to get a root.
Right.
It sure it hit the soil. Yes, it was spoken. Yes, it came out, but it didn't land. Because it was washed away in emotionalism, washed away in a bunch of noise. Mm-hmm. Interesting what we call church today. Mm-hmm. And so he talks about, amen, when he sowed the seed, some of it fell in stony places where there was not much earth. There are people out here today that don't have any depth. When you talk to them and deal with them, and you try to explain some of the most simplest concepts to them, they can't see them. See it. One of the most simplest concepts of all in this earth is that all men were created equal. That Jesus Christ died for every man.
Amen.
Now people say that they know this. They, oh yes, he died for everybody. But then they want to start dividing people up into categories. They want to divide us by color. They want to divide us by nationality. They want to divide us by sex. They want to divide us by age. But yet in the Bible, it tells you clearly, Jesus didn't set any prerequisites for who he died for. He did not make one people great and another people evil.
Right.
We were all in the same condition without him.
Right.
We're all evil. We all need help. And even with him, we have days where we still fall short and come short of the glory of God.
Amen.
Yet, we buy into this because you have people who don't have any depth. They don't have anything where a seed can get a hold on, where it can grow in. Mm-hmm. They will not allow it because they wash it out.
Right.
He says because there was no deepness of earth in verse 5. They don't have any depth to them. And so you're trying to put word into people whom where there's very little earth, where there's very little mental capacity, where there's very little desire to learn, where there's very little will to change, to acknowledge that they might be wrong, to listen, to hear the word of God, because what they want to do is take it in. They want it to be what it fits, as long as it fits what they consider important, that the word has to be in such a way whereas they can mix it with what they have and produce what they want it to produce. But that isn't the case. You cannot. If you go and you plant tomato seed, you're not going to have carrots. You're going to have tomatoes.
Right.
And so the word of God is designed to be planted after you to produce after its own kind.
Amen.
Okay, it's not designed when the word is put in you. It's not designed so that you can continue to be who you are, continue to think the way you think, continue to be what you used to be. But what you have to do is, amen, clear out all your pre-knowledge, all your preconceived ideals, and then be willing. See, that's why when you go in, you till the ground, you get all the weeds out. Before you plant, you pull up all the weeds. See, you get all that stuff out of there. And you gotta get it out. And then you go in and you get your rows lined up so everything's straight, and then you put your seeds in, and then you put dirt over top of it so that the fowls don't get in. Some you can't put under dirt, so you gotta lay straw or hay over top of it to protect it. You don't want it to move. You can't keep moving seed and expect it to get a hold. You know, you can't be here one day, there the next. I'm going to this ministry, going over here. You're never going to get a foundation, a firm foundation. Because what happens is, when God deals in ministries, He deals in a segmented type of stages of learning. Okay, a lot of times people come in and they don't have any faith, they don't have any trust, they've been lied to, and they've seen how other ministries, they're out for money, and they got this going on, and the preacher don't have any discipline, so it takes a while, because they're not going to catch hold of what you're saying, because a seed is not going to start to sprout and germinate until it's been watered some, until it's been cultivated, so it has to sit there some time before you see it produce results. Sometimes, some seed you put in the ground, it won't even bloom that season. And then you have what they call a bumper crop. You have all of a sudden all this crop come up and you say, I didn't even plant that much seed this year. But this was seed that was laying there dormant until such time as it was time to hatch. And a lot of times you have people within you who have talents and other gifts, and they're there and you don't even know they got them, and this has happened to me. And they've been laying there dormant, and all of a sudden this stuff starts blooming up, and you go, oh man, wow.
Amen, that's right.
Here it is, here's the harvest. But you gotta keep on watering. Mm-hmm. You gotta keep protecting it from the fowls. You gotta watch other folks who are trying to get your folks all off base and destroy what you have put in. See, so you got to make the ground right. And then it says when the sun came up, they were scorched because they had no root and they withered away. Sometimes when you're dealing with folks, if they don't get no root, if they don't get down in that dirt, if they don't take root when the heat is turned on, they can't take it. They're fine until you start asking them to do things. They're fine until you start dealing with them about the way they're living.
Right.
Okay, they're good, they sit there, they love you to death. But when you start talking to them about some of the things that they're doing, God's moving you to deal with them because you see that their soul's in jeopardy. You see that that seed is exposed. And that seed isn't in where the place it should be. It doesn't have the depth that it should be. And they don't have any deep roots. And you know that what they're going through, the troubles and the problems that they're going through, are because they don't have any roots. And so you start trying to fertilize around them. You start trying to water them, and they just can't take it. They feel like you're picking on me. You're judging me. You don't have any right to be in my private, personal life. What I do in my bedroom is between me and God, and what I do on my job, you've been spying on me, or who you've been talking to, or who's been talking to you about me, or you just making up stuff, and you don't talk to such and such about what they're doing, but you're talking to me. Why are you talking to me and you ain't talking to them? You let them get away with it, but you're picking on me. This is what you get when you don't have any depth. And when trouble come into their life and you got to tell them the truth of why you are where you are, you're blaming everybody else. It's not them, it's you. Oh, you always on their side. You always choosing against me. No, God is telling me to tell you what you need to know. One of the things you'll find out in counseling, and I've had the time, I've counseled a lot of couples. And they always say, well, you don't treat them that way. You always telling me, you don't know what I told them. Like they don't know what I told you. Because you a couple does not mean, amen, that you're counseled as one. Because everybody has individual problems. Everybody has individual troubles. And you have to deal with people on an individual basis where they are, where God tells you to deal with them at.
Amen. That's right.
Now, there are very few times when you have problems that you just totally innocent. Because there's some things you may have said,
things you have done, seed that you have sown, that now you're reaping a harvest from. And so because of that, because that's your personality, now you have interactions with other people, and because you have this personality, you bring out things in folks that you brand new for. Do you see what I'm saying?
Right. Amen.
And so then people ain't going to take a lot of counseling like that today. Mm-hmm. Because they're taught and trained to blame everybody else. They cannot see themselves. They can't look at themselves. Impossible. They're trying to get one little peek and they can't take it. They can't take it. Oh no, you ain't born there. I was more comfortable just being who I was. Now you won't. Nah.
Right.
I'm going somewhere else where I can just sit and praise God I'm saved, and pastor love me and tell me how good I am and tell me how saved I am. Somebody gets scorching and withered away. Then he talks in verse 7, and some fell among the thorns. And Lord, when the thorns sprung up, oh, they had problems because they choked them. Now, when you are in call of God, and sometimes you can be not everything that you're supposed to be, and when you fall in the wrong places or go around the wrong people, for instance, you're trying to live for God and you keep going to the clubs, you keep hanging out in the bars, you keep hanging out with folks who's partying every Friday night. Oh, I'm not partying, but they are. That's my family. That's what they do. You're hanging around folks that are doing all kind of ungodly things. And eventually, you start to choke. And when you choke, that means you can't breathe. And when you can't breathe, you can't do nothing. See, you got to be able to inhale the gospel of Jesus Christ. You got to be able to breathe and be saved. But when you are around things that are choking you off, it kills your testimony because you're guilty. You can't be the person that you want to be because you know in your heart, and you know God knows. See, conviction will run you off. You'll see people just fade away because the preacher was meddling that Sunday. Everything he talked about, he was talking about me. I know somebody must have told him something about me before I got there. You see what I'm saying?
Amen.
And so, because of this, they just choke. They can't go to that. I'm going to get right, and then I'm going to come to church. That ain't never work. It ain't never work. Many of us, most of us, are set up in some church on some Sunday, and we ain't been right. But we were here.
Right.
We wasn't right. We was praying to God, dealing with stuff. Lord, help me this or that. We done had problems at home this week. Done had problems on my job. Or I got this or that I should have done and didn't do. And I didn't know why. But Lord, help me. That's why I'm here. Because I need help.
Right. Amen.
Now others, it says they fell on good ground. They brought forth good fruit. But I'm going to tell you something. It's lesser of them than it is of the others, because you only see one mention of them. But we've had three mentions of these other folks prior to this one scripture. These ones that didn't waste a good word. They brought forth some fruit. Now a lot of people teach that this is, they went out and they disciples of it in, and that's part of it. But no, the fruit that he's talking about is the fruit of righteousness. It's the fruit of examples when they were tested. It's what they did when they were put in the same situations that these other people were in, and they were able to make the right choice because they were good ground. Mm-hmm. See, they were ready to receive the word of God. They were ready to let go of their life. They were ready to let go of the world. They were ready to miss out on some events. Maybe miss out on some of that. Maybe I don't have a part of this. I can't go with you here. I can't do that there. They were willing to let go.
Right, amen.
A lot of people are not willing to let go of this world. They're not willing to let go of their own ideals. They're not willing to look at themselves and say, maybe I am wrong. Maybe I see it here in the word. And always the word that you hear is but. And when you hear but, that just totally directly refuted everything that God said. When they say, I know the Lord said, but, that ended the conversation of what God said. Now I'm on the throne. I know what God said, but he got to get off because this is my life.
Right.
I'm running this life. Mm-hmm. But I know, Pastor, I need to do this, but there is no but.
Amen.
There's a period. I know I need to do this, period. I am going to do this, period.
Right.
I'm making excuses for me, period. I'm done making excuses for me, period. I see where I'm wrong, ain't no but, period. Hey, I see what I need to do, period. And I'm going to do it, period. That's how you start to change. I don't care, you know, I know they said something to me, but, you know, I shouldn't have said nothing. They did this or that to me, and that's what caused me to do that. But, no. Good fruit. Good fruit. They said this to me. It was killing me inside, but I held my peace.
Amen.
It hurt for a minute, and then I got to thinking about Jesus on the cross and all that he went through, and I began to be glad because I realized, wait a minute, I'm the example in the Bible. Even though I'm not in the scripture, this is the epistle written and read of men. You're looking at the epistle, the continuation of the gospel in Jesus Christ in me.
Right.
I'm now the new modern day New Testament example of what you've been reading about. You didn't see Moses because you wasn't around. You missed Paul. But let me tell you, there's still time to catch Henry Essick. Do you hear what I'm telling you?
Right. Amen.
You see the word is still alive. The examples are still alive. The men and women of God that you read about, there's some of us still walking this earth.
Right.
Amen.
Man, we may not be in the book. Our names may not be mentioned in that book, but we're in the book of life.
Right.
You may not understand our examples, but God in heaven is sitting there watching, and there's a cloud of witnesses that are there to testify that we are doing the right thing. Do you hear what I'm saying?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And so he said, he that have ears to hear, let him hear. If your ears are open today and not stopped up, man, you too can be a man, a child of God. The scripture says in Romans, Lord, who have believed our report? You see, everybody ain't going to believe what you say. Everybody isn't going to believe what the word of God says. But the thing is, do you believe? Are you willing to listen to God? Because there are many people that are called in this world, but few are chosen. There are a lot of people that the Lord has called into to be saved, but they have gone about and left the church of God. They've gone about to live their life the way that they want to live it. Some of them are still in the building, but they are in the building empty vessels. They're in the building shallow. They're in the building that have no root. They just blow in on Sunday, and that's it. They do their thing, and they go home, and you don't see them during the rest of the week. You see, many have been called to this gospel, but few people, amen, have really put it on and lived it, put it on and breathed it, put it on and eat it. There aren't many people who, amen, are willing to let go and let God have their life. But when you understand that only a small number will allow the word to take a permanent root in them. See, many is all about. When you really have a true heart for God, nothing comes before God. Everything, amen, is retained in this person who loves God. Because what you do is you don't just present one harvest, but you present a continual harvest. See, the word of God and the seed that is really truly planted and rooted in a person is what will come out of that person. If you are a saint of God, then you're going to produce this kind of fruit that proves you are what you say you are. Thank God, hallelujah, this morning, because he gave his life for us. He's the one who made it possible for us to follow his example. Because Without the example of Jesus Christ, I don't know that I could be motivated to give myself sometimes. There are things that I want to do that I don't do because of the example that Jesus Christ set. Knowing that he could endure, amen, the things that he went through, and yet having been God in the flesh, and then him telling me that he gave me the power also to become a son of God. That's what I want to be. There's nothing more important than being a son of God. I may be somebody that you reject. I may be somebody that you don't like. I may be somebody that you don't care about. I may say things that offend folks, but I'm not trying to offend you. I'm trying to please God. If what I say offends you, then you are offended at the word of God, because the only thing that can come out of this ground is the word of God. And that spirit that's in me, it makes me fat and flourishing with the word of God. I can be instant in season and out, but I'm always abounding in the word of God. And see, this is a thing that God is saying. Don't just give me 10%. Just don't give me 40%. Just don't give me 60%. But give me 100%. 99.5%. Word in your life. Get all of me. Get every bit of me you can get in you. I want you to look like me. I want you to walk like me. I want you to talk like me. I want you to smell like me. When you come into a room, I want people to look at you. Yeah, you may look strange because you're not dressed like they dressed. You may look strange to them because you don't do what they do. They may whisper and talk about you and say that you think that you are better than they are, but you have to understand that they don't really see you, but what they are seeing is the holiness that I have put in you. They're seeing you clothed with righteousness, and it condemns them. You are the one that I called. You are the one I picked. You are the one that I chose, and you're going to go through some things. You're going to have to endure some things, but one day you're going to get a blessing, and you're going to have an eternal life. You're going to have, amen, the things the world desire to look into, the answer to the mystery of the gospel of Jesus Christ, eternal life.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Lord said in Matthew 7:21, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. Who is it that Lord is going to enter? He said, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven.
Right.
And then see, he said, but. See, that's that but again. See how that but changes everything.
Right.
Because he says, everybody ain't getting into heaven. But. And that but means whatever came first, here's what's going to happen. It's you who did my will. It's you who represented me. And so, there's no greater purpose in life. There's nothing else to live for. If you're living for your children, you're living for the wrong thing. If you're living for your husband, your wife, or your person you're dating, you're living for the wrong thing.
Right, right.
If you're living for your job or your retirement, if that's what you're living for a new car, living for a new house, you're living for the wrong thing. The only thing worth living for, amen, is Jesus Christ.
Amen. Right.
Amen. Whatever you do, don't waste a good word.
Right.
And as you see around you, this is what's happening in church. They're wasting it. It's not just the world. It's people who are in the church. Israel was the church. Like I told you, there were 3 or 4 million of them. And yet, 120 received the Holy Ghost in the upper room, and 3,000 more on the day of Pentecost. Out of all those people, then they went and spread it around, but still it was only a small portion.
Right.
So when you look at the church, we are the church.
Right.
And within the church, right, there's only a small number who truly are dedicated to God.
Right, amen.
Who aren't wasting the word of God. You be one of those.
Amen.
You're going to be different,
right,
than the other folks who say they go to church, who say they got the Holy Ghost and all this stuff. Yeah, they may have it, but do it have them?
Right.
Does it have them? That's what's important.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can look like a saint. You can talk like a saint. Because if you can get a puppet to imitate a man, surely you can get a saint, a person to imitate a real true saint.
Right, right.
Is it live or is it Memorex? Remember,
right,
that commercial? With that, you can tell which one of these is the real and which one is fake.
Right.
They even have cars. If you're not really careful, they call them clones.
Mm-hmm.
They build these clones from the 60s and 70s. I was watching the auto auction last night on, and they had an SS Chevelle clone. The real car was worth, if you found one with the big block 454 convertible, they're selling for over $300,000. This one was immaculate. It was talking about how the parts and all match, and it only sold for $70,000. You see, there is a difference between a real saint,
mm-hmm,
and a clone,
mm-hmm,
or fake.
Right.
So, amen, don't let a good word go to waste. God bless you. And then at this time, thank y'all. We're going to take, ask you if anybody have a need for prayer. We'll open the altar now.